This is video one of a multi-part video series dealing with ratio analysis. And in video one, what we're going to do is introduce ratio analysis a little bit, give an overview of the ratios we're going to use in this series, and gather the data for calculating the ratios. In a couple of the later videos, we'll walk through the specific calculations as well as have a few comments on each of the ratios out there. Now, I want to start with an overview of the ratios that we're going to use for this class. Now, this handout is available in Canvas if you're enrolled in one of my classes. If you're watching this video and you're not in one of my classes, you can get this handout here at the bit.ly address posted up top. What I've done is just put that up in Google Documents, and so you can just follow that link and should be able to print off a copy of these ratios. Now, every finance book that you look at has a slightly different set of financial ratios that they cover. There are tons of different financial ratios out there. Some are specific to particular industries. For example, one of the big ones in retail is sales per square foot. That works great in retail. Doesn't work too well in other industries. For example, that ratio would make no sense in trying to evaluate a company like Merck, which is a pharmaceutical company. So these are just some basic ratios. We've got them segmented into five separate categories: liquidity ratios, asset management ratios, debt management ratios, profitability ratios, and then market value ratios. Each of these categories is designed to give us a little bit different perspective on different aspects of the firm. Now, the first thing that we're going to do with this video is, in order to calculate all these videos, which you can see listed here, we've got quite a few of them, you need lots of different pieces of information. For example, in the inventory turnover ratio, we need the cost of goods sold divided by inventory. When we want to calculate the return on equity, we need net income divided by common equity, or sometimes referred to as owner's equity. So the first thing we need to do before we can calculate these ratios is go ahead and gather the data. Now, in this video, we're going to walk through analyzing and calculating ratios for Pepsi. And you can find the data that we're going to use in the guided tutorial handout. This is available, again, if you're in my class in Canvas. And if you're not in my class, you can go to this bit.ly address right here, and you can download the three pages that include the income statement, balance sheet, and statement of cash flows that we're using to gather the data. If you're not doing this for Pepsi and you're just trying to do this for any other company, a couple of the places that I like to go to are Yahoo Finance, just finance.yahoo.com. They have a great source of data for individual companies. MSN Money is another good source for that. Most brokerages will have access to financial statements for companies. However, if you're really doing financial statement analysis, the places I mentioned give kind of a condensed, here's the financial statements. If you're really doing financial statement analysis, what you need to do is go to the company's financial statements. Every company has an investor relations segment set up online, so you can just go to the internet for that company, find their investor relations. Usually they'll have something labeled financial statements or financial documents, and pull up the 10K, 10Q reports, and those are going to have the financial statements with detailed explanations. So that's really where you want to go if you're doing financial statement analysis. We're just gathering this data to give an overview of how to do the calculations. And what I've got here is a handout we're going to use to kind of record the various values that we need for all the ratios. So these are different numbers we're going to need for the ratios. And then here we've got the actual financial statements. The Pepsi 2011 income statement, 2011 balance sheet, and the 2011 statement of cash flows. We're going to use each of these statements to gather the necessary data to calculate these ratios. Again, what I'd really encourage you to do right now is get out your guided tutorial so you can look at these. It's going to be pretty small in the video trying to follow along if you don't have them available to you. Or if you're watching and you're not enrolled in one of my classes, go ahead to that bit.ly address and print these off so you have them sitting next to you. So let's go back to our gathering the data sheet. Now I tried to organize this a little bit, so we'd start with the balance sheet data and then move on to the income statement data. So the first thing we've got are current assets. Current assets are a part of the balance sheet. So we get out our Pepsi balance sheet. Total current assets. And we need the 2011 data. So that's 17,441, and note that all of these numbers are in thousands. So that's not 17 million, that's 17,441,000,000. We're just going to write that down as 17.441. So now we've got that recorded. Now we want to go to our current liabilities. Current liabilities are also on the balance sheet. Notice the balance sheet is set up with assets, current, and then long-term, then liabilities, and stockholders' equity. So we need our current liabilities for 2011. And that's $18.154 billion. Next on the sheet, we need inventory. Inventory is one of our current assets. If we look on our balance sheet, current assets, they're broken down by category. Inventory is $3.827 billion. Next up is accounts receivable. Now, Pepsi refers to that as their net receivables. Again, scroll over. 2011 data, that's $6.912 billion. Next up, we need our total assets. Still working on our balance sheet. Total assets. Scroll over. 72.882 billion dollars. Liabilities. Here we're looking at our total liabilities. Still on the balance sheet. It's going to be 52.294 billion dollars. Next, we need net fixed assets. Net fixed assets is for our fixed asset turnover ratio, and oftentimes when companies are referring to net fixed assets, what they're talking about is their property, plant, and equipment. So we go find property, plant, and equipment, scroll over, $19.698 billion. Last item we need from the balance sheet is the common equity that's near the bottom here. Now, one thing we should note is if the company has preferred stock, we don't want to include that. Now, in Pepsi, we don't have that to worry about, so we can just look at the total stockholder equity down here at the bottom. Scroll over, $20.704 billion. Now we want to go to the income statement. So now we want to get Pepsi's 2011 income statement. Again, all numbers here are in thousands. Now, typically the market price is not included on the income statement, but I went ahead and included that in the dividend and the dividends per share on the income statement. So we have those values. And again, you can get these financial statements at this bit.ly address here. It's just going to take you to my Google Docs folder where you can download this particular file. Okay, so first thing we need are sales. Sales sometimes are referred to as revenues. So first line we see is typically going to be a revenue or sales line, and that's what we've got here. 66.504 billion. Next we need our cost of goods sold, or as we see it listed here for Pepsi, the cost of revenue. It's going to be used to calculate our gross profit margin, and that's 31.593 billion. Now next two items we have are operating income and EBIT, our earnings before interest and taxes. Quite often these are the same. In many cases, operating income and EBIT are going to be the same. In Pepsi's case, they are slightly different here. Our operating income is 9.633 billion. And our earnings before interest and taxes, it's our EBIT, 9.69 billion. Now notice these numbers are very close to one another. Like I said, quite often they're going to be exactly the same. Next, we need our interest expense. Interest expense listed right before or right below our EBIT. In 2011, that was 856 million. So 0.856 billion. Next, we need our depreciation. Now, depreciation is going to come from our statement of cash flows. So we grab our Pepsi 2011 statement of cash flows right up here. One of the first adjustments from net income is our depreciation. It's 2.737 billion. Our market price, again, a lot of times you'll just get today's market price from someplace like Yahoo Finance or any of 100 different sources online. But for this example, we're going to use the market price of the stock that I recorded earlier when I prepared this handout. And that at the time was $66.35. Earnings per share, we're actually going to calculate that. That shouldn't have been on this sheet. Dividends per share, that's provided again on the income statement. Now that won't always be on the income statement, but again for this handout I went ahead and reported that. $2.03 was the dividends per share that Pepsi paid out in 2011. And lastly, we just need the number of shares. And the number of shares down at the bottom of our income statement. Again, this won't always be on the income statement, but usually you can find it on the income statement or balance sheet. And the number of shares outstanding is 1.564 billion. That gives us our data. And now we're going to use this data to go through our ratio calculations and a few other the following videos.